Welcome again to Climate Responsive Architecture videos. We are into the next part, unit number 2, part number 2, solar radiation. So we are going to understand how the sun is going to give us the heat and how the heat energy or the heat transfer is going to take place because of the sun's movement. So if we understand, the solar radiation is nothing but the radiation received from the sun. The radiation is called as the short wave radiation. The radiation which is reflected back is called as the long wave radiation. So generally we have the short wave radiation from the sun. So this picture is taken from a book called Manual of Tropical Housing. So you can understand, it gives you a clear picture of how technically the sun's radiation is going to come inside the earth, okay, and how it is going to be absorbed by the earth and how it is going to be reflected from the earth, okay. So it happens in such a manner, during the daytime it's going to have a certain amount of radiation, and during the night time, since the atmosphere is getting a bit cooler, so it is going to certainly have a re-radiation. So the heat travels from a hotter zone to a colder zone, so during the night it tries to re-radiate. So if you see, this is the top of the atmosphere. As you know, on top we have other stratospheres, etc. So the sun's radiation is going to be there. So it's going to be like the radiation arrived from the sun is almost 100%, in which the 50% is going to be received by the earth. So you have a direct radiation which is reflected from the ground, so it's almost 5%. So a few radiations are reflected by the clouds, so it's almost 20% is reflected by the clouds, and few are absorbed in the atmosphere due to the dust particles and due to some kind of pressure, etc., air pressure and molecules, small molecules. So that's going to be about 25%, and some of the radiation is going to be diffused on the ground because of the vegetations or because of the shrubs and because of other ground properties, etc., and 27% of it is going to be on directly on the ground. So it's almost like 50% of the solar radiation is going to be on the ground as a short wave radiation, in which few are going to be getting transferred into the building. So by means of your fenestrations are nothing but openings. So we understand Earth's thermal balance is equal to heat absorbed is equal to heat lost by Earth. Heat is absorbed during the daytime and heat is lost by the Earth. It's a natural phenomena which is going to take place. So if you see again, the reflected, the absorbed radiation as sun short wave, or the radiation which has come from the sun as short wave radiation, will again be reflected back to the atmosphere by means of long wave radiations. It will be reflected immediately, or it might get reflected during the night, etc. So now we have it as long wave radiation which reflects back about 20%, and due to some kind of evaporation, so which is done because of the water bodies and etc., so that evaporation content is almost 20%, and because of the convection and then again radiation, so that is almost going to be 10%. So the 100% from the atmosphere is going to be 50% as we saw earlier, and this 50% which is falling on the ground will be reflected back because of the the phenomena is called as the long wave radiation. So this is how the Earth's thermal balance is going to be there. So we have the Earth's energy budget, which is a very interesting chart or very interesting picture, which you can see there is going to be incoming solar radiation. So everything is given in watts meter square, so which is heat and energy. So again, it's reflected by clouds, reflected by surface, and few things are emitted by the surface, and there is going to be outgoing infrared radiation, there's going to be an atmospheric window, there is a back radiation again, there is few kind of evapotranspiration and change of state, and because of the change of state it is going to have, there is going to be a lot of condensation, and because of condensation there is going to be a lot of rain, etc. So now this is a very interesting chart which is called as the energy budget, where the energy, incoming energy is also equal to the is almost equal to the outgoing energy. So this is the basic chart which you can understand how the sun's energy is calculated. So we have a general term in solar radiation which is called as the irradiation, which is the technical term which must be used. So we first call it as the irradiance, which is calculated as watts per square meter. It is nothing but the instantaneous flux or energy flow density or a power density at a certain space. For example, if there is a space of about just 1 meter square, okay, just 1 meter square space is there. So that space, if we are going to have if you are just going to have a if you're just going to have a small radiation effect on that 1 meter squared space, it is called as the irradiance for that moment. So for example, that at 3 o'clock, exactly at 3 o'clock or something like that. Whereas irradiation, it is on the same space, same 1 meter squared, but for a longer duration. But for a longer duration, it says the same instantaneous flux which is collected for a longer duration, which means an energy quantity integrated over a specific period of time. So for example, from 3 to 5 o'clock, or for example from morning 10 a.m. to 3 a.m. or 3 p.m. etc. So that is the collection of heat which is there in the same space. So that is called as the irradiation. So generally Earth receives a lot of irradiation because it's a collective heat. So we generally calculate it for a day or a month or a year. So annual irradiation, you can actually see what is your annual irradiation chart if you put it and see in your net, internet or web series. So again, the term irradiation is also termed as insolation in the software, Ecotec software. It is generally, it is mentioned as like 58,000 kilowatts per hour at 3:30 p.m. on west side. That means the heat gain is actually started from 6 a.m. till 3:30 p.m. So on western side. So the radiation also depends on what side it is going to receive. So if it's going to be the western facade, or if it's going to be the eastern facade, etc. So according to the facade systems, the radiation is actually going to vary. So it it also says it is per unit area. Okay, so that is also there in terms of insulation. So again, if you see the solar insulation, solar radiation or irradiation, is dependent on the angle of incidence. So according to the angle of incidence, so if it's on horizontal surface, if it's at 12 o'clock in the afternoon, so it's good, the angle of incidence is little lesser. So the sun is exactly at zenith angle, so you will receive about 342 watts per meter squared of radiation, okay, at about 1 hour or etc. But what happens is when you have an angle of incidence which is almost, if the sun is tilted in the morning, so your exposure area is more, but the radiation effect is little lesser. Okay, so 242 watts per meter squared is the lesser instantaneous flux which is received. So, but the problem is, but according to the observation, if it's for a longer period of time and if the exposed area is more, then your heat gained is also more. So, for example, even if it's for a longer period of time, the exposed area is lesser, but here the exposed area is 1.5 times more than this. So your heat gain will be little more because of the exposure of the area. So again, if you see in the equator, there is a little bit of lesser exposure of the sun, but whereas if you see in the Arctic Circle, there is a larger area of exposure because of the sun's rays. And if you see, there are different types of radiation which is actually measured. So one is called as the diffuse solar radiation, one is the direct solar radiation, and adding these two is called as the global solar radiation. So if you see, it is called as global irradiance or global irradiation maybe. So we call it as the beam radiation, which is called as the direct radiation, which is the straight line from the sun, and it's a vertical quantity, depends on the angle of incidence. So this is called as the direct radiation. So diffuse radiation is of two types. One is like the radiation which is when it is arrived or when it is coming from the atmosphere, it is getting scattered. So that scattered radiation is called as the diffuse radiation. And a few radiations which are received to the earth is again absorbed or reflected on the ground or nearby surfaces or the nearby buildings, etc. So that is called as surfaces, whether it is ground or whether it is going to be a built surface which is going to be vertical, etc. So that depends. So we have the global radiation, which is called as the direct radiation, plus the diffuse radiation. The diffuse radiation is of two types. One is from the atmosphere, and also one is from the reflected from the ground or nearby surfaces. Now this picture clearly shows you, like if you have a small room, etc., you have a direct radiation. There is a atmosphere and there is a lot of dust here or humidity here. So because of that, it gets little diffused here. So this is the diffused radiation which you receive. And because of the reflected radiation from the buildings, okay, this is the reflected radiation from the buildings. So altogether, it is also called as the global horizontal radiation. So the radiation is generally measured by an instrument called a spiranometer or solarimeter. So So which gives you the measurements in British thermal unit or in watts per square meters or meter square. So the solar radiation chart, which shows you like how much hours of length of day length is going to be there in each and every latitude. So which you can see whether it is going to have a length in daytime, etc. in the equator, how many hours are going to have a sunshine, etc. It's a very interesting map which the students or the designers must see, because while you see some visual picture, you will understand. So now if you see the picture, it's the world picture, it's 1985 to 86. So if you see the red color means it is very high, the radiations are very high, and the green color is green color, and a little bit of pale green is like the radiations are a little lesser, and the radiations are very less if it's blue color. So you can see like the net radiation is very high in the equator line, so it affects the sea or the ocean, gets a lot of heat during the daytime, and it is leading to the evaporation, and because of the evaporation it is leading to the condensation in the tropical countries, and due to which there is a lot of rain, and due to which there is a lot of vegetation, and due to which, because of the sunshine, there is a lot of vegetation, and various kinds of vegetation can be seen in the tropical region. So India is a very agricultural based economy which depends mostly on the sunshine hours, etc. Of course, here in, if you see in Africa, there's a lot of tropical forests. Again, if you see and above South America, there is a lot of tropical forests again. So you can understand by the chart, like because of the exposure of the sun on the equator, the radiation levels are very high. So when you go here, the radiation levels become little bit inclined, and there are some few desert regions, which is called as the arid regions. And on top, the radiation is very inclined, and there is going to be a lot of colder regions because the inclination is also there, and the exposure of the sun is also little less, the direct exposure is little less. So we have the colder regions of Arctic and Antarctic on the top and bottom surfaces. So if you see again, this picture gives you a clear idea of the equinox periods and the solstice periods. So during the March and during the September, the radiation effects are in the middle of the earth, whereas in June it is on the northern side of the earth, and in December it is on the southern side of the earth. As we saw, it varies in terms of northern hemisphere and southern hemisphere. So this is the net short wave radiation, which is very high during your March and September. So we feel the exact summer after March, and that is we call it as the second summer, or the little bit of hottest period during the September, as per the location and the monsoon also. So again, the same picture which is taken in a recent data, March 2008 and September 2008, etc. So we can see how the direct normal radiation is very high here, 2800 kilowatts per hour. It's extremely high here because of the equator line. On top, it is little lesser because of the lesser exposure, etc. If you see again, interestingly, in India, according to every season, okay, there is a lot of variation solar radiation. So in January, we already know that the sun is actually on the southern part, or it's inclined towards the south, so the exposure is more in southern India. So February it goes up, and March it goes up towards the north, and April almost it fills up the whole April. It's almost the summer in whole of India, and May is extremely hot. So you can really find when you have a composite climate, the May is going to be extremely very hot, and again June is very very hot in the northern parts of India. After June there is going to be a little bit of monsoon, so again on top it's going to be a little hot, but there is going to be monsoon here, so the radiation levels are a little bit lower. The monsoon is slowly coming down in August, and September it's going to be like little summer, because again from July the sun is going to move towards the south. July, August, September it will reach the equinox. October again it will be little hotter, and November it will go towards the south, and December it will be on the south, and it's very cold in the northern regions. As we know, the composite climate like Delhi and also the few parts of the Kashmir, etc., are going to be really hot during your really cold during your winter seasons. So this is the way we understand by means of the chart, radiation chart of India. So again, you can see in Tamil Nadu, like January, February and March, and a few seasons, like how the sun's movement is going to get varied accordingly, and the sun's radiation is also controlled because of the monsoon. So if you can see, like in Coimbatore and few parts of Pollachi and few parts of Theni district, etc. So it's controlled because there's monsoon. So when there is monsoon, there's going to be cloud cover, so the radiation effects can be little lesser. So when the monsoon goes out, so the radiation effects will be little higher. Okay, so because of the cloud cover. So generally, the radiation depends on the factors such as the orientation. So if you are building or the built space is oriented or if it's inclined, the radiation levels are very high. Here the radiation levels are exposed to a larger area, but the intensity of the radiation is little lesser, and it also depends on the movement of the sun. So it depends on every place. Like New Delhi, it is different, and Bombay, it is different, and it is depending on the what you call the orientation. Also the radiation levels are depending. And if you have a direct radiation to the building, and there is going to be a re-radiation in the night very easily. But if you have a cloud cover, there is going to be a diffused radiation, but again there is going to be re-radiation in the night, which is actually blocked by the clouds. So a warm humid climate, for example, like Chennai or etc., so there will be a cloud cover due to the oceans present nearby. But again, what happens when the re-radiation happens, the cloud cover is blocking few of the re-radiation elements, the heat, etc., etc., and it's going to form a little bit of heat junk or heat inside the near the spaces itself. So again, it depends on how it falls for the humans, etc., factors affecting the radiation in humans. So now this was the project done by me, and to understand, previously we saw the shading analysis of the same project, which is the development control regulations project. So what happens is, if you can see, like the radiation is very high on the roof, okay, and the exposure is little less, because if the buildings are little closer, the exposure can become less, and because of the mutual shading. Again, these two buildings are there, it is little less because of the shading of the buildings. And the road is exposed very highly. If you can see the peak radiation, the road, it's an asbestos road and it's a little bigger road, so the radiation is very highly exposed in the road. So this is just to get a clear understanding how the radiation levels are varying in northeast, west, south, and on the roof because of the sun's exposure. Thank you. We are going into the next chapter called as the heat transfer in part number 3. So we will see the heat transfer in part number 3. Thank you.